gosh, I've been reading these devotionals and sharing them emotionally and, you know, getting, actually, I've got to be honest, I've been getting a kick out of it. It's like, you know, when God wants to go boom, 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 I'm like, all right, I'm punch drunk. I love it. But as serious as God has been in these other devotions, you know, it can't be said enough that his love was demonstrated in that he died. He didn't have to. He could have stopped it at any moment in time. As serious as these have been in sharing about sin, forgiveness, mercy, kindness, about hell, God didn't have to allow his son to suffer before he died. Yet he did. And you know, God doesn't have to be scarred for the rest of eternity. But for you, he is. It's been a heavy day. I may take a nap. Or go find some place in the heat and think about what Jesus did. In Spurgeon, oh boy, I have no idea what he's going to say or what God may say through him and how God will use this in your life. I only know in my life it's been a pretty serious day of realizing what God has done for me. Only you shall not go very far away. Exodus. This is a crafty word from the lip of the ark. This is a crafty word from the lip of the arch tyrant Pharaoh. If the poor bondaged Israelites must needs go out of Egypt, then he bargained with them that it shall not be very far away. And the observation, and under the observation of his spies, and not too far away for them to escape the terror of his arms. After the same fashion, the world loves to love not the conformity. Wow. After the same fashion, the world loves not the nonconformity of the nonconformity, or the dissidence of the dissent. It would have us be more charitable and not carry matters with too severe a hand. Death to the world and burial with Christ are experiences which carnal minds treat with ridicule, and hence the ordinances which set them forth is almost universally neglected and even contemned. Worldly wisdom recommends the path of compromise and talks of moderation. Don't get too carried away. According to this carnal policy, purity is admitted to be very desirable, but we are warned against being too precise. Truth is, of course, to be followed, but error is not to be severely denounced. Yes, says the world, be spiritually minded by all means, but do not deny yourself a little gay society, an occasional ball or dance, and a Christmas visit, or, you know, being able to go here and there and have a drink or two. After all, what's falling down once or twice gonna do? What's the good of crying down a thing when it is so fashionable and everyone's doing it? Multitudes of professors yield to this cunning advice to their own eternal ruin. They become like the world and adapt to it. If we would follow the Lord wholly, completely, with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind, with all of our being, with all that we are, we must go right away into the wilderness of separation and leave the Egypt of the carnal world behind us. We must leave its maxims and its excessiveness and its pleasures and its religion that it does have, for the world has a religion, and go far away to the place where the Lord calls his sanctified ones. Will you go out there to party, or will you go out there to see God? When the town is on fire, our house cannot be too far from the flames. When the plague is abroad, a man cannot be too far from its haunts. The further from a viper, the better, and the further from worldly conformity, the better. To all true believers, let the trumpet call be sounded. Come ye out from among them, and be ye separate. You know, Spurgeon describes something that we can do without it being such a self-righteous Puritanism, that who cares if Friday night is the night, you know, to party? Do you really care? You won't, because the day will come when you either have found yourself partying on a Friday night and busted for drinking and driving on a Saturday, or getting yourself into a predicament that you can't get out of because you decided that you wanted to go and do what you thought was important. It's a party. It's a not that bad. So, you know, you could give in and do it. After all, some of your other Christian friends are. But, you know, I never had that chance and that opportunity. Because for whatever reason, God decided he was going to do something weird with me. Like, that's a shock. And I had maybe I'll share it one day, or put a plaque up or something, but I had a devotional I used to read that it was included in, and it was called Others May, You May Not. And it described something that was what I wanted all along. I didn't want to be like every other Christian. You know, I didn't want to be like all the rest of what I saw, everybody being so either too holy or too righteous or too this or too that or too compromising or whatever. And I could never put the balance of it all together. You know, it was like if I was too holy, then it was like I was condemning the grace that had saved me and the mercy that God had for other people that weren't so quote-unquote holy. But then if I chose not to do those things, it was almost as though, you know, people condemned you because you didn't want to do those things that you knew were bad for you. So somehow, God chose for me, and in this one devotional describes it that he causes sometimes circumstances, if you're willing to give it to him, to move you in the direction that you should go. But is that what you want? It's what I wanted. So, who cares about you? You know, go on your way. You know, trip, stumble, fall down. I don't care. You know, you're dumb enough to stick your nose in, like I have a nose, look at this one, in other people's business, and then you get burned. Why did you stick your nose there in the first place? Or why did you indulge? Why did you commit sin? Why did you do these things? One reason. You thought you could get away with it. And you did. Or you thought so. Until it caught up with you. And I can tell you this, the only thing that's going to stop you from sinning is sin. Sin is the only thing that stops you from sinning, because suddenly you realize that it's a price too big that you don't want to pay, and it's a burden that you don't want to bear, and it's something that you don't want to deal with anymore, ever again in your life. Because it's only sin that will stop you from sinning. God tries, he warns, he explains, he gives you the freedom and the opportunity, and you will, one day, regret the sin that you might be in. So really, it's all up to you. You can choose to go and step aside with God and go up the mountain. Or you could choose to be in Egypt and enjoy the world in its ways when it comes crashing down, like on Pharaoh's army, and the waters overcame them. Or you could choose to be like the children of Israel, partying and creating their own religion with Aaron, and coming up with a golden calf and worshiping it, and dancing and enjoying, for eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. Or you can do the one thing that one man did. And he went up the mountain, and he sat down with God, and God said, Moses, the people have done a great sin in my sight. I am willing and ready to destroy all of them and start over with you. Think about that. God willing to destroy the people that had just come out of Egypt, like you, and start over with someone like Moses. And listen to what the man of God said. Lord, don't do it. Better to... I should die, than you should destroy them and ruin your name's sake among all the nations. But he interceded for them and begged his own life be taken rather than the children of Israel be destroyed. That's a Christian. That could be you and I. Where do you want to go today? Ask God, and he'll lead the way.